Right. Good morning, West Side. Well, I hope that you've noticed that love is a pretty big deal around here. And I'm not saying that I hope you've heard us overusing the word in our teachings and our conversations. I'm not saying I hope you've seen us decorating walls with hearts and roses, nothing like that. What I'm saying is, I hope you've noticed that even if it's your first time here today, I hope you've already noticed that this church is serious about love, not just as a word, but as a way of living, and not just as a feeling, but as like a habitual behavior. It's the way that we treat people with love. I hope you've noticed that we're serious about loving people well, both within this church family, within these walls, and outside these walls, and that we're seriously devoted to getting better and better at loving everyone. And if you haven't noticed this yet, man, that could mean that we have failed you in some way, which would be tragic, because the scriptures that we use for our guidance and direction of how to live this life, they are serious about love. In one of the stories told in Matthew and Luke, a couple of the Gospels, a rabbi comes up to Jesus, and he asks him, Jesus, what is the most important commandment? If you had to aim your whole life at just one of the hundreds of commandments that you find in the Old Testament law, which one would it be, Jesus? And Jesus says, well, I'm going to give you two. Number one, love God with everything you got. Love God. And the second one follows closely behind that one. Number two is love people as you love yourself. You can sum up the whole Old Testament law, he says, in those two commands to love. It's a big word. And in John, another gospel, just hours before he's handed over to be crucified, Jesus is having a heart-to-heart with his closest followers, his disciples. And he says this, he says, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. Don't just love others the way you love yourself. That's good, and I've actually told you to do that. That's good, you keep doing that. But what I'm now calling you into is a higher standard than even that. Love others the way that I've loved you. And listen to what he says next. He says, by this way of loving, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. People will know you're a follower of Jesus by the way you talk? No, not necessarily. They'll know by your t-shirts? No. That might be how they know you're a Westsider, but that's not how they know you're a Christian. Now, Jesus says the truest identifying mark of a Christian is the way they love. They love the way that God has loved them. And then you've got arguably the most shocking statement repeated twice in John's letter to the churches when he says twice, God is love. Now listen, it's not uncommon to describe God with a single adjective. God is awesome, God is good, God is kind, he's loving, no problem. But to refer to him as a singular noun, running the risk of reducing the God of the universe to a singular concept? Well, John must have understood this singular concept, this word love, to be sufficiently large and expansive and pure that he could comfortably use it to name the God of the universe. This God is love, and his people must be people of love. And if they aren't, they aren't his people. Our scriptures are serious about love. So for the next several weeks, including today, we're going to be talking about love, not from John and not from the Gospels, but actually from a pretty famous passage written by Paul. And even if you haven't really been to church much, you still may have heard this passage because it often gets read aloud at weddings. Not just because it's all about love, but because it's particularly beautiful. It's just a beautiful passage. Paul probably didn't have any idea that it would end up being wedding decor, but he did probably intend for it to be read out loud. Paul is in the middle of writing this letter to one of his churches that he helped establish in the Greco-Roman world, the city of Corinth. And those Corinthian Christians, well, they had some problems, right? And which is actually why Paul is writing to them. He's trying to clear this stuff up. And like any young church, they had questions that Paul is answering in this letter. But he's also trying to address some of the deeper issues in that church community, which could possibly be summed up as ego problems. This church had some ego problems. I mean, they're struggling to remain united. There was lots of boasting and comparison games going on, competitiveness over a number of things, like who's more spirit-filled and who's more gifted and who's more knowledgeable, all that stuff. Now, they're already valuing some really important things. They're off to a good start. They value knowledge and wisdom, being in tune with God. They clearly value honor and order in society. They value not just logic and sound reasoning, but they value the kind of faith in God that moves mountains. Their problem isn't in what they're valuing as much as what they're undervaluing. They seem to be undervaluing love. They just don't seem to be getting how central, how foundational love is to all the other good things that deserve to be valued. And so, in a kind of climactic point in his letter, Paul decides to break into a kind of written eloquence that's really better spoken, if not performed from a stage in the public square. And he's doing all of this to lift up, to elevate love in that church, establishing that virtue of love as central and foundational to every other good thing. And so he says this, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1, he says, "If I speak in the language of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I might boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, it's kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable and it keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. Love never fails." We're going to spend today and the next several weeks unpacking several words and phrases from that list as Paul is giving definition to the word love. But today, I want to zero in on really just that first word that he uses in his list, patience. He says, love is patient. Is anyone else surprised that Paul starts with that word? I mean, if you were to ask Paul, what's love? He says, well, the first thing that love is it's patient. Huh. I mean, if that were me, well, I don't know what I would say. I don't know how I would answer that question, but I really don't think I would start there. Paul does. Think about that. Say that you are Paul's scribe. You're helping him write this letter to these Corinthians. And you've addressed, 75% of the issues that need addressed, but you haven't yet gone for the jugular, Like you've not been skirting around the elephant or anything like that, but you've not yet hit the bullseye. Not yet gotten to the root issue. And Paul is like, all right, it's time. We got to get to the root. It's time for this letter to call these Corinthian Christians up into love for each other. I want to challenge them. I want to invite, I want to inspire them to love each other better. And, being the helpful scribe that you are, you're like, all right, Paul, I got it. It's time for a creative piece. We're going to drop a creative love bomb right in this letter right here. We're going to make it beautiful. We're going to make it rhythmic. Maybe something you could read at a wedding. Paul's like, keep talking. And you're like, okay. Let's brainstorm. I got a whiteboard right here. When you think of love, Paul, what are some words, some phrases that come to mind? You shout them out. I'm just going to write them right here on the board. Go. And Paul sits back in his chair and he thinks for a second. And he says, well, the first word that comes to mind is patience. Because to love someone well is to be patient with their shortcomings. Is that how you think about love? When you think about loving others well, those in your home, your workplace, your church family, your church community, other drivers on the road, when you think of loving people better, do you think of being more patient with them when they fall short of your expectations? Is that the first thing that comes to your mind? Maybe it should be. The word Paul uses here for patience is a Greek word. It's actually a combination of two other Greek words, a word for distant and the word for wrath. So patience is distant wrath, like wrath that's a long way off in the distance. It's a long time before anger arrives, a long fuse. That's what patience is. Or as other places in the Bible spell it out, to be patient is to be slow to anger. Maybe you've got a short fuse. Maybe it doesn't take much to light it either. And once it's lit, it doesn't take long for that spark to get to the powder keg. And maybe you have wished many, many times in your life that you were more patient with others. If that's you, man, you got to pay attention to this next line. You got to write this next thing down. It's from James chapter 1, verse 19. James 1:19. Write that down, print it out, put it on your fridge. Here's what he says. He says, you must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. That's such a great phrase, slow to anger. Now, if you know your Bible, you might recognize that phrase, that because James is borrowing it from elsewhere in the Bible. It's actually from that set of words and phrases, descriptions of God, that's used over and over again throughout the Old Testament. First, very first appearing when God is officially introducing himself to the Israelites after delivering them from Egyptian slavery. And he says this, he says, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. And phrases from those lines right there, that set, get repeated probably a dozen times throughout the Old Testament, the Psalms and prophets, making it clear to God's people that he is slow to anger and abounding in love. He wants his people to know that about himself so that they might more accurately reflect him into this world. He wants his people to be slow to anger, abounding in love. Back to that line from James. If you're asking, how can I be slower to anger? How can I be more patient? James might actually be offering you part of an answer here. Listen to this. He says, be quick to listen, be slow to speak. And then when you do those two things, you will be slow to get angry. That might be one of the things that James is saying here. Notice how those first two go together. More often than I would like to admit, when my wife and I are working out a disagreement, it might look to outsiders like I'm listening to her. Well, yeah, I hear enough giggling. I think you might know where I'm going with this. You know, I might not be alone. What I'm actually doing is I'm actually listening for things to argue with her about. I'm listening for holes and weaknesses in her argument, planning my response for when it's my turn to talk. I'm just waiting for my turn. Now that might be good arguing, but it's terrible listening. James says, be quick to listen, eager, hungry to understand the other. You flip that switch in your brain to get curious about what the other person is thinking and feeling. Don't presume you already know what they're going to say, even if you think you've heard them say it 1,000 times. Assume that you've missed something. They think you have. So lean in and listen. And even after you have listened, even then, be slow to speak, slow to respond. Allow yourself to actually take in deeply what the other person has said to you. Good listening does this. Good listening typically includes repeating back to the other person what you're hearing them say, signaling to them that you understand their concern, that you've actually heard what bothers them. And you don't move forward. You don't speak your part until they say you have understood them. Be quick to listen, eager to understand the other, and slow to speak, slow to present your opinion. You do those two things, and the result? You're going to be slower to anger. You will be more patient with the other. Another thing, if you want to be more patient, you may need to be honest with yourself and just admit that anger often feels really good. I mean, it's way more fun than sadness and fear. It's way more fun to be angry than to be disappointed and confused. And I think I can explain why. Maybe you've noticed that anger feels powerful. Have you noticed this? It feels so strong. I have the right to be angry at you. I'm looking down on you because what you did to me was wrong. Rage feels so powerful, which explains why we so often use it to escape those far more miserable feelings connected to powerlessness, like sadness, fear, shame. Whenever you spot yourself getting angry, just pause. Rewind just a little bit and play it back in slow motion. And you'll often find, just before you get angry, you'll find a moment where you felt weak or small or like you don't measure up. And you didn't want to feel that, so you opted for anger instead. It happens so quickly. If you've ever been told that you have an anger problem, I'm not your counselor, but I might suggest to you that you might not have an anger problem. Anger might just be your favorite way of avoiding other feelings that you have a problem with. Other feelings you don't want to feel. Other feelings that probably trace back to feeling weak and small. Of course, it gets you in trouble, so you want to deal with it. So you may need to see that what anger actually offers you is the illusion of size and strength and power. It's not real power. It's illusory. Rage is not real strength. It is weakness. Calm is what's actually strong. Now, I know that sounds backwards from what the world would say, but it's worth getting used to because in this kingdom, things are backwards. Calm is the new strong. Now, that shouldn't be too surprising to anyone paying attention to the king of this kingdom, right? I mean, he defined strength a little differently, didn't he? This king whose coronation was the public execution, marked by mocking and insults with whips and spit. This king, crowned with thorns, was raised up, elevated on a cross. Yeah, when that's your king, things are going to feel a little upside down from everybody else, from the world. And did you catch what he said when they were killing him? He said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." You want an image of patience with people? You want to take with you a picture of a God who is slow to anger and abounding in love? Man, it's hard to beat that right there. You want an image of strength, actual strength, strongest guy in the whole scene right there. believe it or not, is the one who's hanging on a cross, calling for mercy on those who put him there. Can you imagine? Can you imagine if Christians, followers of Jesus in this world, were known, had the reputation for that kind of Father, forgive them patience? Just think about that. In this world that is just crazy with outrage, anxiety off the charts, in this constantly reactive world, can you imagine if church people had the reputation for being that kind of strong? So when a Christian is in your workplace, your thought is you just know that guy is going to be calm, not anxious about anything. Everyone else in the meeting is worked up, stressed out about the problem, panicked, racked with uncertainty, reacting all over each other. But you can always count on that guy to be just calm, in tune with the problem. He knows what's going on. He's aware of the problem, but he's not anxious about it, not reactive. He's just patient. Strongest guy in the room right there. Or that Christian in your college classroom, her whole upbringing, her whole belief system is just getting slammed. She's outnumbered, but somehow she's not getting defensive. You can just tell. You can tell she disagrees with everybody, including the professor, but she's patiently listening to everyone as if they matter to her, because they do. You really can see that. She's listening very well. She's calm. Strongest person in the room right there. Or when you step into a Christian home, they're not perfect, that's for sure. That's obvious. But what you notice is how patient everyone is with each other. They're slower. They're not in a hurry to be heard. It's as if everyone has plenty of time to say everything that needs to be said. It's a strong home right there. This anxious, reactive world desperately needs to see a church like that, doesn't it? Now, you don't need me to tell you that technology trains us to expect immediate results. Like, immediate. I mean, my patience with Siri runs pretty thin when it takes her like a full second to convert my speech to a text, right? Like, two-day delivery, we expect that. We are so effectively trained to expect whatever we want, whenever we want it, which is typically right now. We have been reprogrammed effectively to forget a pretty obvious truth. We've forgotten that very few things actually need to happen right now. Very few. Somehow we have forgotten that. And the more trivial something is, the more easily we're tricked into forgetting it. Trivial things often feel like they need to happen right now, but they don't. The more important something is, the more we actually expect it to take some time, maybe years. So if you're a parent or a coach or a teacher or a supervisor, if you're anyone in any kind of leadership position where you are influencing and shaping the lives of others, and you're wanting to be more patient with those who are learning from you, you gotta remember that you're playing the long game. Yeah, sure, you want to get your short game right. You want to aim for the bullseye every time, every day. You don't blow your short game, but don't for a second think that it all hinges on your short game. If you make that mistake, you're going to be fighting every battle as if they're all equally important instead of choosing your battles wisely. Setbacks are going to feel catastrophic. The day-to-day ups and downs are going to be exhausting and confusing and disappointing, and of course, you're going to be far less patient when they don't learn the lessons that you think they need to know right now. You got to remember, you're actually playing the long game, where not every battle needs fought. Ups and downs are to be expected. Setbacks are actually just opportunities to teach the more important lessons, and you are far more patient with them as they learn those lessons. The most important things they will ever learn will never be learned right now. Those are actually the things that take years, sometimes decades, to mature into. You're playing the long game, which is, of course, the one that God is playing with you. Listen, the journey from Egypt to the promised land could have taken only 11 days for those ancient Israelites. God made sure it lasted 40 years. 11 days it could have been. He led them. They were following him around in that Sinai desert wilderness for 40 years. Why? Because he had some important lessons to teach them. And he knows it takes time for important lessons to sink in. And God always prefers deep transformation to superficial. And he's willing to wait as long as he needs to. Now, I've got three really great daughters, and even great girls can be a little inconsiderate to each other sometimes. And whenever that happens in our home, if they don't, for whatever reason, work it out on their own, I might intervene saying something like, okay, sounds like we need to start over with each other, huh? And they hear that, they know that's a prompt for somebody to begin apologizing. And sometimes the apology isn't as deep as it should be, you know? And it sounds something like, okay, I'm sorry for disrespecting you. Can I go play now? And it's like, hold on. You just smacked your sister in the face with a 2x4. She's wailing, she's bleeding. Let's take another pass at this apology. I think you can do better than that. So as a parent, I've learned that sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes, when your kid wants to speed things up, that's your cue as a parent to slow things down. And yeah, that's going to drive them a little crazy, but that's your job as a parent to drive them a little crazy sometimes and to make sure they catch at a deep level eventually. Make sure they catch the most important things before moving on to the less important things. Now, if you find yourself a little impatient with God, he's not operating according to your timetable, and you're getting a little frustrated that he isn't getting you to your destination right now. Maybe you're single and you're wanting to be married. Maybe you're married and wanting to be parents. Maybe you're in debt or you're in some other kind of pain and you're wanting relief. You're persecuted. You're wanting to be vindicated. You're in spiritual bondage, wanting to be completely free from all of the entanglements of sin in your life. And you're asking, God, can you hurry up, please? Heads up. He might just be playing the long game with you. It might be that you're not waiting on him as much as he is waiting on you. He is patiently transforming you into a person of love. And that takes time. Now, typically, the end of the world is a scary topic for our surrounding culture. It's a doom and gloom genre. You know, it makes for a good movie plot line, lots of screaming and terror and so forth. But Christians are always a little backwards, a little upside down from their culture. And so when you are in Jesus, when you are borrowing his righteousness, you're borrowing his identity. When you're in Jesus, you don't just face the end with confidence. You actually, as strange as it might sound, you actually look forward to the end. The end means the end of evil, the end of corruption, both within us and around us. So yeah, you long for that day. It can't come soon enough. And the Christians in the first century were so eager for that day that they were actually starting to get a little impatient with God. They're like, God, would you please hurry up? Where is he at? He was supposed to be here like 20 years ago. And so Peter gives them this word of assurance. He says, the Lord isn't really being slow about his promise to return and end human history. He's not slow as some people think. No, he is being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. That's a really good West Side Everyone line right there. Don't think of him as being late. He's not caught up in traffic. He's not dragging his heels. He's not procrastinating or nervously deliberating on a tough decision. Don't even think of him as being slow, but he is being patient, slow to wrath, not wanting anyone to perish, holding the door open for everyone to repent, to turn their lives away from sin and toward him. He is patiently playing the long game. All right. I got a whiteboard here. I'm going to write the first thing that comes to your mind when I give you a statement. And maybe it's a statement you've heard 1,000 times. That's okay. I'm going to give it to you anyway. God loves you. He loves you. And you sit back in your seat and you think for a second and you say, yeah, he does. He sure does. He has been so patient with me. His love is patient because love is patient. May that love root itself so deeply in our lives that everyone around us, everyone we come in contact with here in this world, might come to see that our God is slow to anger and abounding in love.